and welcome to EPG Pathshala on Women's Studies. This particular module is on women in history, and the particular topic is on women in Buddhism. I am Dr. M.N. Rajesh from the Department of History, University of Hyderabad, and the writer of this content is Dr. J. Limayanla Awo, an independent research scholar from Nagaland. The present module actually looks into the evolution of the Bhikkhuni Sangha, or the Sangha particularly which has women in it, and then proceeds on to explain the evolution of the Bhikkhuni Sangha and its transformation over the period, that is from the ancient to the early medieval period, and also its mutation in different cultures, particularly in the Tibetan tradition, and the effects of this Sangha on monasticism with special reference to women. Our story begins 2500 years ago, and to be more precise, 2550 years ago. It was in 1956 that the 2500th anniversary of the Buddha was celebrated in India. Though there are certain disputes with regard to the date among the three different traditions, all the three traditions agreed on 1956 as the date, which was the 2500th year. And thus we travelled 2500 years back to ancient North India, which underwent a rapid transformation, which was not only religious but also social and cultural in nature. And the author of this great transformation was none other than the Enlightened One, or Buddha, who is known popularly as Siddhartha Gautama before he became the Buddha, and later he is known as the Gautama Buddha. The context for the rise of Buddhism is very important, as Buddhism rose in a milieu in the 6th century BC in North India, which witnessed what is known as the second urbanization. This was a period in ancient North India when we see the rise of towns, specialization in crafts, which led to a surplus, and then this surplus was traded, which led to the rise of a mercantile group. While the merchants became socially in the same situation, they were actually economically well off, and this led to a mismatch between the social and the economic position. This created a ferment in society, and this ferment in society therefore created an audience which was craving for equality. It was not only the merchants but also many other social groups who actually were looking for equality, and this message of equality was actually delivered by Gautama Buddha in a very simple way. One of the important aspects of his simple message was that for any deliverance, there was no need of any outside agency, but each person was himself or herself responsible for one's own spiritual emancipation. It was this message that led to many people embracing the Dhamma. The term Dhamma is used to describe Buddhism, whereas the Sanskritized version of the term Dhamma is Dharma. Thus, North India witnessed not only a ferment in religion but also a social and cultural ferment, because we see 63 different traditions. Though the texts label this as sects, when I say texts I mean the 19th century and later English texts which wrote the history of India. So we also use the term sects and traditions interchangeably, but to sum it up, we see that there was a myriad fusion of many different traditions and also blossoming of many hundreds of new ideas and ideologies which address the concerns of the day. So what were these concerns of the day is one of the important questions. Among the many concerns of the day were economic stratification, which was brought about by inequality in the economic sphere owing to large-scale agrarian expansion and the rise of towns, which led to an exchange. And therefore, this exchange led to the concentration of wealth in the hands of some people, and at the same time, the dispossession of some others. So this created a significant rift. While we see the Gahapatis and the Setis who became wealthy, but they craved for social equality. The society was also at another level craving not only for social equality, which has been understood by many historians, but it has to be linked with this economic process. Therefore, we see that many of the texts which prescribed a strict division of society into the different varnas could not stand the scrutiny of the time, because the prescribed position of society according to the fourfold varna system did not hold water on account of the new changes. These new changes spread all over North India, and this period what is known as the second urbanization was the theater to these changes. It was during this period that the egalitarian message of spiritual emancipation and also liberation found an echo among many different sections of the society. It was all based on one aspect, on in the Buddhist and the Jaina traditions, which are also known as the heterodox sects, on the idea of karma, or what is known as the theory of cause and effect. So each person was responsible for his own karma. So therefore, one has to cultivate good karma to beget good results. What was the effect on women? Now, when the Buddha started the Sangha, the Buddhist Sangha was predominantly composed of men. But women did not find an equal space, because women did not actually participate in the early beginnings of the Sangha. Therefore, we see that there was also some stirrings among women for equality, and some of them were interested to join the Sangha, but then they could not get an easy entry, as there was no tradition of asceticism. Earlier, we have stories of many rishis who had gone to the forest during the Upanishadic period. The Buddhist community was composed of the monks or the bhikkhus, and the upasakas or the laymen, and the upasikas or the laywomen. The monks or the bhikkhus were supplemented later by the bhikkhunis or the nuns, and the upasikas and the upasikas, who are the laymen and the laywomen respectively, thus completed the Buddhist Sangha. How did the bhikkhuni Sangha start? The bhikkhuni Sangha started in a particular historical setting which was not very easy. We have a historical character named Prajapati Gautami, who was the aunt of the Buddha, and when she wanted to start the bhikkhuni Sangha, she did not get an affirmative answer, and therefore she, along with 500 women from the Shakyan community, all of them donned the ochre robes, shaved their heads, and then requested the Buddha for entry into the Sangha. This was a historic moment in which we have a new community of nuns known as the Bhikkhuni Sangha. And thus, the historic element in this was spiritualism and renunciation was one important avenue which was open to women, and they need not necessarily be tied only to the household. This was a legal and cultural and morally accepted way for women to enter the Sangha, which marked a historic beginning. From this, the Sangha expanded as patronage to Buddhism increased. With the rise in patronage towards Buddhism, we had the flowering of many Buddhist monasteries, but then at the same time, we do not have an equal rise in the number of bhikkhunis or the nunneries, which was the institutional setting for the bhikkhunis. This was one important problem. But then we get an information about the bhikkhunis or the nuns from the Therigatha. The Therigatha is a story of the elder nuns known as the Theris. So we have the Theras, or the elder monks, and then we have the Theris. The term Thera is used to designate the Theravada tradition, or the tradition of the elders. As Buddhism has three important traditions, one is the Theravada tradition, which is followed in the southern countries and therefore also known as southern Buddhism, that is in Sri Lanka, Burma, Laos, Thailand, Vietnam, that is particularly South Vietnam, and Cambodia. It was earlier wrongly known as the Hinayana tradition, or the lesser tradition, the term Hinayana being coined by the Mahayanists. We also have the Northern Buddhism, or what is known as the Mahayana tradition, which is followed in China, Japan, and Korea, North Vietnam, and also in Taiwan. In addition to this, we also have a third tradition known as Vajrayana, or Tibetan Buddhism, which comprises part of the Tibetan culture area centered on Tibet, Ladakh, Lahol Spiti in India, in Northern India, and then we also have Sikkim in the Eastern Himalayas, Bhutan, northern parts of Nepal, and the easternmost extremity of Tawang in Arunachal Pradesh in the Eastern Himalayas, along with the entire country of Mongolia and parts of the region bordering China, which are situated in the provinces of Gansu and Sichuan, and also in the three autonomous republics of Russia, that is Tuva, Buryatia, and Kalmykia. Kalmykia is an interesting political entity because it is the only Buddhist political entity in Europe and is an autonomous republic in Russia. The point of highlighting all these three traditions is that they all followed diverse cultural patterns which led to differential status for women, which is very, very important. There is now some level of difference among the three traditions with regard to the position of women. Firstly, we do not have any nuns in the Theravada tradition, whereas we have nuns and nunneries in the Tibetan Buddhist tradition. But the problem is that they cannot become fully incarnate nuns. We have only one reincarnate nun, whereas we have around 4,400 reincarnate lamas in the entire Tibetan culture area, though the number has significantly reduced. Further, the degree of geshe or doctorate in theology is not open to nuns. But His Holiness the 14th Dalai Lama, as he is popularly known as a spiritual and temporal leader of Tibet, is working towards making this a realizable possibility in the current period. And steps have been taken to frame syllabus and allow nunneries to conduct the geshe examination. This again leads us to one important question, which takes us back to 6th century India, which has surfaced in historiography. While some suggest that the core of Buddhist tenets contain egalitarian and feminist tendencies, some others point to the perpetuation of male dominance and patriarchy in Buddhist thought, or even criticize the religion for playing a role which led to the subjugation of women. How does one come to terms with these two diametrically opposite views? We see that the historical context also changed. One of the important reasons is that the interaction between Buddhism and the other religious traditions in India led to exchanges and also impacts from Buddhism and also upon Buddhism. One of the important impacts was the rise of Tantra, which was an important religious movement in beginning from the 5th to the 7th century, which stressed on unorthodox ways of learning and thus opened up many important avenues for women from diverse backgrounds, that is, women from different classes, from different castes and different social backgrounds and different modes of worship which were deemed unorthodox or which could not be practiced. For example, they used alcohol, sexual activities, meat, and also prohibited forms of expression like dancing. It was this element of Tantra which was later domesticated and which became an inseparable part of the Tibetan Buddhist tradition, which is also known as Vajrayana. Tantra also impacted Mahayana to a very large degree. It is this tantric residue which forms an important element in the intervention of women's history, particularly when we look at Buddhism. Now, when we go to the later period, we also see that one of the important texts that has still survived from the Pali tradition is the Therigatha. So the Therigatha is one important text which is the only sole repository of women's texts from the ancient period. Here we find stories of the elder nuns and their views on society, and more particularly the status of women and their position in ancient India and also within Buddhism, and more specifically within the monastic setting. We have been shuttling forth between the modern period, the medieval period, and once again to the early period of Buddhism, that is 6th century BC, to locate the position of women and trace their position in the general matrix of Indian history with particular reference to women in religious traditions. Now, with the exception of the Therigatha, most of the texts were authored by men, which gives a gross disparity in the representation of women. So, in theory, the path of renunciation was open to women, but in practice it was not followed fully. The texts frequently, though they focus on women, they focus on women within the household and display an anxiety about the impact of women leaving the household to become nuns. Thus we find that though we have nuns, the number of nuns is not as great as one would expect. Why was this so? A few examples in the text also suggest that maleness and femaleness were illusory and irrelevant categories. Most of the present two alternative paths to attaining bodhisattvahood for women. This is in the Mahayana tradition. Some sutras also declare that a woman could enter this path, but unless she was reborn as a man. We were centering on the Therigatha, which was the most important text. And once again, it has to be reiterated that Tantras also, in addition to the Therigatha, stand out as the important texts that represent women. So while the Therigatha is the only text in ancient India, we do have Tantras. And one of the important texts which has come in the modern period is titled as Buddha's Lions, which talks about 84 tantric adepts, and some of them were women. And we also have interesting episodes of many of these women attaining liberation in very unorthodox places and settings, like graveyards after consuming alcohol, and in very unorthodox postures and settings that were deemed offensive to the mainstream society. However, these were domesticated and they thus became part of the Mahayana Buddhist tradition and also the Vajrayana Buddhist tradition. While Tantra rose as a movement from the 5th century AD, we also have tantric influences not only in Buddhism but also in Jainism and Hinduism. Thus, we therefore have Buddhist Tantra and Hindu Tantra. We are primarily concerned here with Buddhist Tantra, and the transmission of these Tantras was also part of some of the important monasteries. These monasteries were known as the Mahaviharas. The term Mahavihara is not just a large vihara but a monastic university, and one of the most important monastic university was the Nalanda Mahavihara in today's Bihar, bearing the same name of Nalanda. The decline of the monastery started in 1206 in India with the large-scale destruction of Buddhism owing to the Turkish invasions and also lack of patronage. Though there was some revival under the Palas and later the Senas in the region of Magadha and later in Bengal, the core area, that is Magadha region, did not witness a large-scale revival of Buddhism. Incidentally, the traditions of the Nalanda were transferred to Tibet, and Tibet did not have to undergo a 1000-year-old evolution from the early Vihara to the Mahavihara because they had an easy template. And this template therefore formed one of the important bases for the Tibetan tradition, and this is referred to by the Dalai Lama frequently as the Nalanda tradition. Thus, the monasteries of ancient India, which were known as the mother monasteries, have their daughter monasteries in Tibet. And now, after 1959, the decline of monasteries and large-scale monasticism in Tibet on account of the Chinese invasion led to a large number of Tibetans fleeing Tibet and coming to India in exile along with the Dalai Lama. Thus, these new monasteries were destroyed but rebuilt in India. So we have therefore the original Nalanda monastery, which was a mother monastery in India. Then we have the daughter monastery in Tibet, and therefore we have the granddaughter monastery, with both the mother and the daughter monastery being in a state of dysfunction. But the important aspect is that the Nalanda tradition, which also is heir to some of the important texts and practices, continued from Nalanda in Tibet with some minimal interventions and interpolations, and was later transferred to South India and Himachal Pradesh, where we have large number of Tibetan settlements. It is here in these settlements that some of the most important debates on the role of women is proceeding today. Along with the Tibetan refugees, we also have many other women from regions as far as Bhutan, Mongolia and parts of Russia who are inmates in these monasteries. And therefore, one of the important questions in their petition is, when will women have access to the Geshe degree or the highest degree in Buddhism? So towards this end, the 5 major classics and the 5 minor classics are already part of their curriculum, and they are already eligible for entry into the other examinations and are being conferred the other degrees. Now, we shall look on to the other important aspects on that affect women in the Buddhist circles. One of the important question is the role of women's sexuality. It was deemed as something which was very dangerous because not only was it powerful, but it also distracted many others from their own spiritual aspiration, not only women but also the other monks. So therefore, though the path of renunciation was open to women, the texts frequently focus on women within the household and display the anxiety of women in the nunnery. So this has not been overcome, and is till today remains one of the important mindsets that has to be countered. Like other forms of classification, the categorization in Buddhism also is at sometimes problematic. Though at one level the categorization of male and female is seen only as illusory, we have many texts and stories. The stories are important because the stories form the main interface between the reception of the text and the lay audience. While the texts by themselves are written in classical languages and are accessible only to a literary elite, most of the women who enter the Sangha are largely influenced by the stories which are part of their living culture. So we have some important texts. The important texts fall under different categories, and primary among them are the Vinaya texts, or the texts which focus on monastic discipline and which were written immediately after the Buddha. And in these texts we have injunctions against lying, stealing, taking life, and also correct etiquette for eating and wearing one's robes. Next we come to the Therigatha, which is in fact a collection of poems in verse form, the authorship of which is attributed to elder nuns who lived during the lifetime of the historical Buddha. These verses by women from the ancient Indian period are among the oldest recorded voices of women from any historical period, which is very important. And they attest to women who renounced the world, lived in caves and in forests, and attained high levels of religious experience through their practice of the Buddha's teachings. As these are the only surviving texts authored by women in the ancient past, they have been retrieved and are being celebrated in the modern period to find support for religious reform of women in the Buddhist societies. We have the other Nikaya texts, and we also have the Apadanas, which are popular in Sri Lanka and Myanmar, particularly the Divya Avadana. Then we also have the Dhammapada and the commentary on the Dhammapada. The Dhammapada means literally in the footsteps of the Dhamma, and these are a collection of short utterances encapsulate the exchanges between the master and the disciple, and in the form of the verses. Then we also have other texts which have come up in the different languages, particularly in Sinhalese, Thai, Burmese, Tibetan, which later became the Latin of Central Asia, and another set of texts, particularly in Chinese and Japanese languages. Today, it is interesting to see that large-scale monasticism among women in Buddhist societies is found in two regions, particularly in the Tibetan culture area and secondly in Taiwan. While one may explain Taiwan as a case of a society which is highly developed in terms of both economy and technology, the impetus for women to join the Sangha in Taiwan comes from their conflict with modernity. Whereas in Tibet, the story is different, because pre-modern Tibetan society, the term pre-modern is stressed here because it refers to Tibet till the period 1959, when Tibet had a large-scale encounter with modernity only in 1959. Till this period, we had large number of monasteries numbering more than 7,000 in Tibet according to some estimates, and these monasteries, or gompas as we know, were one of the most important mediating institutions between the society and a very harsh landscape, a harsh landscape which did not support a rising population. So therefore, many adult Tibetans, according to some estimates a quarter of the population, whereas according to some other estimates one third of the population, somewhere between these two, voluntarily left their homes and joined the Sangha so as to reproduce the society and economy. In this situation, the eldest son remained and looked after the parents, while the second son in all families joined the Sangha. So these gompas were staffed by the lamas. Similar to the gompas or monasteries were the ani gompas or the nunneries, staffed by the anis or the nuns, equivalent to the bhikkhunis in the tradition of the early Theravada period. When we finally come to the conclusion of this glorious episode of Women in Buddhism, we see that the journey of women in Indian tradition has not been a smooth one, and 2500 years ago the journey had an important intervention in that it offered an institutional space for women through the Sangha. So women could thus voluntarily leave their homes without fear of being stigmatized or without being fear of ostracized, as they could legitimately join a monastery which was in conformity with the cultural and religious traditions. This very important aspects opened avenues for women. However, this journey was not smooth, but we should also not discount the important contributions which is had made, and most important among this is in a surviving form is the Therigatha, or the text which talks about the verses collected by the elder nuns. Then We have the later period, particularly the early medieval period, which saw the formation of regional kingdoms in India and consequently the decline of Buddhism, with the final blow being dealt by the Turkish invasion. But before the Turkish invasions of 1206, we also had the flowering of large Mahaviharas in eastern India, which coincidentally were also influenced largely by the Tantric movement, particularly the early Tantras, which were not classified as Hindu or Buddhist Tantra, which saw the large-scale participation of women. It led therefore to creation of unorthodox spaces and spaces which were proscribed. And finally, we have the transformation of these traditions, particularly into China, Japan, and more importantly into the Tibetan culture area, where they flowered for another 800 years. The final blow came with the rise of modernity and the collapse of Tibet, and therefore the reformulation and coming to terms with modernity of this tradition, which again takes us back to the question of, will women be able to achieve their own spiritual emancipation? And the Dalai Lama is working towards the Geshe degree for women, which would be an important step. Thank you.